Here's the real reason that Drake and Kendrick Lamar are beefing. And I use beef lightly in this sense because it's more subliminal tension that's never really been brought to the surface, but dates back at least since 2013. A lot of you guys love the series I did on Drake and Kanye's relationship. I think it has like 3 million combined views on TikTok. And the most requested video I got was to do one on Kendrick and Drake, so let's get right into it. I'm gonna call this series Rap Relationships. So back in 2011, when Drake dropped Take Care, which was his sophomore album, Kendrick had yet to drop his debut, Good Kid, Mad City. So if you look at the scale of where they were at in their careers, Drake was already basically a superstar. If not a superstar, then a star. Best I Ever Had, Over, Miss Me. The dude already had hits. Headlines was on this album. And Kendrick had just dropped Section 80, which, amazing project, was well respected within the rap world, but he was nowhere near Drake's level of fame yet. And on Take Care, Drake actually lets Kendrick have an entire track, the Buried Alive interlude. This is kind of an unheard move, but it's interesting because the song itself tells a story of Drake and Kendrick meeting at a secret location in Toronto. And here's what Kendrick says about the meeting.
React like an infant whenever you are mentioned. My cruising in Toronto. Hit me off the sailor, thought he was gonna sell me a false word like the rappers I know. Felt like the initiation. A reality living in the matrix. We talk casually about the industry and how the women be the tastemakers for the shit we making. Then he said that he was the same age as myself, and it didn't help because it made me even more rude and impatient.
So Kendrick says he reacts like an infant whenever Drake's name is mentioned. Basically, he's saying he's a little bit insecure with Drake's level and fame and success at the time when he's not exactly where he wants to be in his career. And seeing the way that Drake was moving, even in this interaction, even in this specific meeting, Kendrick starts to see the next level of fame that he can attain. I have this weird feeling that Drake sent this beat to Kendrick and wanted him to get on a verse and like actually do a collab, but Kendrick sent back this elaborate story and it kind of fit the narrative of Take Care and what Drake was dealing with fame. So he kept it. Then on Kendrick's debut album, he returned the favor by having Drake as a feature.
Good God, what you doing that walk for? When I see that thing move, I just wish we would fight less and we would talk more.
Then Drake even took Kendrick out on tour along with ASAP Rocky on the Club Paradise tour, which is funny if you look at it now because ASAP and Drake are not cool because of Rihanna, and Kendrick and Drake don't seem to be cool either, but would have been an amazing tour. Wish I could have seen it. And Club Paradise might be the most underrated Drake song. It's my favorite Drake song ever. Let me know yours in the comments. He even referenced this tour on 4PM in Calabasas.
When he told me take a R&B nigga on the road, and I told him no and drew for Kendrick and Rocky.
We are in 2013, and this is where the relationship starts to go awry. Did I use that word right? Yeah, that's what I meant. Okay, let's get into it. The tension really all started with this verse right here.
Miscellaneous minds, never explaining the mind.
The infamous control verse.
I'm usually homeboys with the same niggas I'm rhyming with. But this is hip hop and them niggas should know what time it is. And that goes for Jermaine Cole, Big Crit, Wale, Pusha T, Meek Mills, ASAP Rocky, Drake, Big Sean, J Electron, Tyler McMillan. I got love for you all, but I'm trying to murder you niggas. Trying to make sure your core fans never heard of you niggas. They don't want to hear not one more noun or verb from you niggas.
Honestly, I feel like this verse shifted the landscape of hip hop for the next 5 or 6 years in a lot of ways. Also, I do have to say, I kind of feel bad for J Electronica because he dropped a dope verse, very poetic, very prophetic, but not a single person has ever heard it. Not one. Nobody made it through Kendrick's verse and said, I need to not run that back. So, J, if you're watching this, love you. You're one of my favorite MCs. Great verse. I heard it. But this song was supposed to be on Big Sean's Hall of Fame album. Big Sean said he couldn't clear it and ended up leaking the song prior to the album's release. I think he probably just didn't want that to take over his whole album rollout, especially because there were comments that Big Sean made that made it seem like he rewrote or redid a bunch of his album after hearing Kendrick's Good Kid because of the quality of the project. But that's besides the point. So, of course, Kendrick name-dropped all of the people who he respects in the game, who he sees as his peers. Now, Drake seemed to feel a way about this verse, not just the verse, but the fact that Kendrick dropped that verse and then seemed to be super cool with Drake and it was like just rap. Even though from my perspective, that's clear that Kendrick was doing that. In the next bar, he actually says, "What is competition? I'm trying to raise the bar high. Who trying to jump and get it? You better off trying to skydive." But allegedly, the day after the control verse dropped, they were at an award show or an industry event. Kendrick daps up Drake, says it's all love, said it was just rap, and Drake takes it away. I think Drake was like, wait, you're gonna come at me and then this is all, we're all buddy-buddy? This is weird to me. If you're gonna diss me on a song, diss me. because he said this in an interview. I didn't really have anything to say about it. It just sounded like an ambitious thought to me, that's all it was. I know good and well that Kendrick's not murdering me at all in any platform. So when that day presents itself, I guess we can revisit that topic. The topic, not that topic. Don't want to misquote him. He's referencing clearly the line where Kendrick said, I'm going to murder you guys. He said, nah, Kendrick, you're not murdering me on anything. I am more successful and in a better position. And I think Drake thinks at this point in time, a better rapper than you. He was also promoting his Nothing Was the Same album. He sat down for an interview with Elliot Wilson for Crown, and here's what he had to say about the verse. Actually, we're gonna need to put that in part three. I'll start off with that. Let's get right into it. Drake is talking about Kendrick's Control verse. This is right after it dropped, and he is promoting Nothing Was the Same in an interview.
And that verse was, he's giving people like moments, you know, like that verse was a moment to talk about. Are you listening to it now at this point in time? Okay. And then it was real cool for like, you know, a couple weeks. But like, if I asked you, for example, like, how does that verse start? No, do you remember? No, and like, now mind you, it'll go on in Complex and Rap Radar, give it like verse of the millennium and all that shit or whatever. But like, I'm just saying, it's like, you know, I think that Kendrick has like the utmost potential, man. Like, you know, I see Kendrick tomorrow, I'm gonna dap him. I didn't feel a way about that verse. I get it. I get the moment. Like, you know, he's a good guy. And like, I know that verse had no malice behind it because I saw him 5 days later at the VMAs and it was all love. So it's like, he didn't come on there on some wild, like, yeah, I'm in New York, fuck everybody, don't look at me. Like,
I'm the king.
So it was one of those things, it's like, I almost wish he had come in there on that shit because I kind of lost like a little respect for the sentiment of the verse. If it's really fuck everybody, then it needs to be fuck everybody. It just can't be halfway for the sake of the people. But you know what I'm saying? Like, for real, that's just how I feel.
There's so much to unpack, which I'll give my opinion on in a second, but it's ironic that he actually kind of brushes off Kendrick as his competition at the time, and here's who he said his biggest competition is. This is in 2013.
So I'm basically talking about, like, you know, there's one guy who's up every night thinking about how to get better and how to do things bigger, and, you know, that's Kanye West. He's like, you know, he's always going to be the guy that's trying to outthink and outdo, you know, everybody. So for me,
he closed that by saying that Kanye's his biggest competition at the time. So let's unpack this real quick. To me, this is where the beef became real because as much as Drake said he doesn't care, it's clear in his tone of voice, it's clear in his body language. The dude cared a little bit, okay? He felt a way about the verse. He maybe felt like he had helped Kendrick so much with the tour that he put him on, putting him on Take Care, and for him to turn around and you know, just name drop him for fun, for some clout and attention. He might have felt a way. Now, my personal opinion on this is that I think Drake took this way too sensitively. I think, yeah, he could have replied on record. He could have had some fun with it. They could have gone back and forth and had a competition. But when he says that you can't just do that for competition and then show love the next day, I don't agree. Plus, Kendrick is known for doing this. He literally had a verse over Monster back in the day where he did the exact same thing and people just forget about it. I'm going out with Kanye. You've been fiascoing us. You doggy, Mr. Andre. Eminem. If you've watched this far, it's about to heat up on records. So Drake wasn't too happy with Kendrick's Control verse, but he did respond with a record on Nothing Was the Same, which he was clearly finishing up during the time of that verse. Here's some lines on the language that were directed at Kendrick. Why they been lying, but your shit is not that inspiring. Bank account statement just look like I'm ready for early retirement. Fuck any nigga that's talking that shit just to get a reaction. Fuck going platinum, I looked at my wrist and it's already platinum. I am the kid with the motor mouth, I am the one you should worry about. I don't know who you're referring to, who is this nigga you heard about? Someone just talking that bullshit, man, someone just gave you the runaround. Niggas down playing the money, but that's what you doing, the money down. I don't waste time putting money down, I just go straight to who got it and buy it and care. Don't flag me, Universal, don't flag me. I'm promoting the music, okay? We're just diving in deep, okay? Pause. No pause. Let it run. Also, I love how whoever made that lyric video said the motor mouth. He clearly said, I am the one with the motor mouth. That is going to be important for the next bar, so don't misconstrue that, okay? He said motor mouth, as in somebody who runs their mouth a lot. So on the verse, Drake is basically saying, yeah, I know what you did with the Control verse, but you're just doing that for a reaction. I'm still the guy. People are gassing you up, saying that you're next up, but I am still in the position on top of the game. He also makes a lot of money references here, which to me isn't the most effective thing in beef ever. But it seems like he's basically just saying, I'm on a different level of success. I'm platinum. I have all this money. Don't even try to compare yourself to my level of success yet, Kendrick. You still got a long way to go. That's why I would think he would say so much about money. But anyways, I digress. Kendrick replied by basically saying, why are you getting so sensitive about this, bro? There was no real beef, but now that you're taking it there, I'm taking it there.
You either corny or an opportunist. I let you eat, now go back to church and still crack this at communion. What are we doing? I'm about to crack the Da Vinci Code. And nothing been the same since they dropped control and tucked the sense of the rapper back in his pajama clothes. Ha ha, joke's on you, high five. I'm bulletproof, your shots have never penetrated. Pin a tail on a donkey, boy, you benefit. I got my thumb on hip hop and my foot in the back of your ass. Aftermath, get the last laugh.
People were making fun of the way Drake dressed at the time, so rapper in his pajama clothes, calling him sensitive, saying like, why'd you take this so personally? And saying that your subliminal shots cannot penetrate me. Pause. I'm bulletproof. The high five was honestly one of the better ad-libs, if you want to call it, that I've ever seen in a rap beef. And Drake also had these lines on the remix to a Future song around the same time.
So niggas out of hood like I'm from there. So you know it's all good when I come there. I hear you talk about your city like you run there. Then I brought my toy to your city. You my son there, nigga, but I had to come through for the remix. Oh, I haven't done a verse in 8 weeks, shit. And if a nigga said my name, he the hot shit. But if I say that nigga name, he still the hot shit. Fucked up, lucky I'm feeding to the gossip. Niggas that like they don't know, but they should know. Yeah, I just think it's funny how they dangling the bait, but I'm the one that's killing niggas on a hook stuff.
Basically referencing how Kendrick said his name, but if he says Kendrick's name, then Kendrick still gets most of the attention and most of the buzz from it, and he's actually doing Kendrick a favor in that situation by replying. He also mentions how Kendrick says he's the man in his city, in Compton, but Drake's come to LA many times and sold out a lot more in terms of numbers at that time in 2013 than Kendrick had. I mean, Drake even brought Kendrick to an arena tour in LA. So he probably, again, he felt a way about it. And when asked if the language was about Kendrick, this is what Drake said in an interview at the time. He said, I don't ever want to get into responses. It's a commitment to go there. The language is just energy. What it was inspired by, I'm sure that and other things. It's just me talking about, I never once felt the need to respond to the record. The sentiment he was putting forth is what he should have. Of course you want to be the best. Where it became an issue is that I was rolling out an album while that verse was still bubbling. So my album rollout became about this thing. What am I supposed to say? Nah, we'll be buddy buddy. Mind you, I never once said he's a bad guy or I don't like him. I think he's a genius in his own right, but I also stood my ground as I should. And with that came another step, which I have to realize, if I'm being baited, I'm not gonna fall. Jordan doesn't have to play pickup to prove that he could play ball, no offense. He does end it by saying there's no real issue and that people wanna see us tear each other down. I don't wanna give them that. There's no point, I have no ill feelings toward that guy. It's just like, it's there for me if I want to fall for it. I'm just too smart for that. And he references that bait line on that Future remix. Also, this was the cover of the magazine. It looks kind of creepy though, with Drake staring at me. I don't like that. Let's go to the next one. So even after all that, it did seem like it was kind of love between the two. I mean, Drake at OVO Fest in 2014 praised Kendrick with a lot of love. He literally says while J. Cole is on stage as a guest that Kendrick is also another king and he wishes they were all on stage together. And he said Kendrick should be here. Showed him a lot of love. But not too long after that, the beef seems to reignite. Because remember that motor mouth line from the other video? It was Kendrick replying to that on J-Rock's Pay For It.
I'm on a hill, King Kendrick, resurrecting my vengeance. Been dissecting your motor mouth till I break down the engine. This ain't a warning shot, this a relevant henchman. See my opponent, then cease your existence. It ain't our friendship, baby, I'd rather die alone.
If you're still here, I appreciate you for watching. Dedication. I'm into it right now, okay? It's getting good. So basically in the last video, we talked about the Pay For It verse where Kendrick was basically saying, I don't care, we're not friends. I'm cool with ending the friendship. He says that in the verse. He calls out Drake's motor mouth line from Nothing Was The Same and said, this isn't a warning shot. This is, what does he say? This is me dissecting your diaphragm or something crazy. Anyways, it's real on record beef now. Then on to Pimp A Butterfly, Kendrick seems to throw a couple shots at Drake, but we didn't know it was at Drake at the time. I am sweating. I always turn off my air conditioning to make these videos so it doesn't make sounds. It is hot in here. But Kendrick on King Kunta says this.
I got a bone up here. I don't want you monkey mouth motherfucker sitting in my throne again.
Hey, nigga, what's happening?
I'm mad. But I ain't stressing. I can dig rapping. But a rapper with a ghost rider. What the fuck happened?
Oh, no.
swore I wouldn't tell. But most of y'all sharing bars like you got to buy the bunk in a two-man sale.
Basically, he's saying he knows at this point that Drake has ghostwriters, or has had writers, or has worked with some people on some verses, however you want to put it. There were rumors in the industry, but Kendrick was basically kind of airing it out, like, I know. So don't try to come at me because I might air your stuff out. I know I said I wouldn't tell, but if it goes there in this beef, we're not even in competition because I'm writing all my own shit and you're not. That's basically where Kendrick was coming from with this song. He also was kind of establishing himself as the king of rap and saying that he might have even surpassed Drake's level of fame and success, whereas on all of the other shots, that's where Drake was coming from. Like, I'm bigger than you, little homie, sit down. Drake's response to this comes on the Game's 100, where he basically says, I could have had your lane, bro. I could have stayed in this conscious underground, woke rap lane. But instead, I wanted to be a pop star. I wanted to be the biggest artist in the world.
I would have so many friends if I held back the truth and I just gave out compliments. I would have all of your fans if I didn't go popping. I stayed on some conscious shit. I would have so many more friends if I lost my success and my confidence. I'm in the club every time that they play the competition. If they even play the competition, then I seen the response they get. Yeah, nobody's even hearing it on top of the pyramid.
Basically saying, you know, he makes music that reaches the masses. You can hear his stuff in the club. He could have done that, but he decided to do this. And still, he's claiming he's on top of the rap game. Also, I'm giving a lot of analysis here, but there's a great video by this channel. Shout out them. Mini Chats is called, on YouTube, and they have all of the disses back to back to back. If you're just looking for, like, the lyrical sparring, go watch that video. So in 2015, Kendrick takes two shots at Drake on Dr. Dre's Compton album, which a lot of people said was going to be his Detox album. I don't think so. I think Detox still exists out there in some other form that we may never get. But Compton was a dope album, and Kendrick did take shots at Drake.
Yeah, I'm fucking with Ice now. I'm fucking with shit that you only can get on an overseas flight now. You scared of my heist now. But still I got enemies giving me energy, I wanna fight now. Subliminal sending me all of this hate. I thought I was holding the mic down. I thought I was holding my city up. I thought I was good in the media. You think I'm too good in my video, but really no clue, you idiot. I just can't help myself. Even when that record spin, every now and then you hang yourself. Cause I got the green and gold. With a million souls, plenty more. I'm a dollar figure. With or without the diamonds though. To you, I'm just another.
So that whole thing wasn't a shot at Drake, but basically what he's saying, I got enemies, got a lot of enemies, got a lot of people trying to drain me on my energy. Kendrick references both of those lines there, and he says something about subliminals, and Drake had just thrown shots at him subliminally on 100. The six, Drake was referencing the six a lot on If You're Reading This. Kendrick said he's gonna send six people to bury Drake if they ever get into a real beef, if it's actually, you know, names are being called and it's on record. Kendrick's thinking Drake doesn't want to mess with him. And honestly, it seems like Drake didn't really want it either. Like, it didn't seem like Drake really threw too many shots other than this, maybe, on If You're Reading This.
Every time they talking is behind your back. Gotta learn to line them up and then attack. They gon' say your name on them airwaves. They gon' hit you up right after like it's only
referencing Control once again. See why I said that Control verse changed everything?
And like your boy from Compton said, you know this dick ain't free.
He also threw in a light reference on that Khaled song, but I didn't see that as a shot. I just saw that literally as him showing love to Kendrick, referencing a popular album within the culture. But you let me know. Maybe that was him, like, poking fun at Kendrick. But Kendrick didn't seem to be letting up at all, and in fact, on the Heart Part 4, I think this is where Kendrick actually goes the hardest at Drake. I think a lot of this verse is directed at Big Sean, but a lot is directed at Drake.
Don't tell a lie on me. I won't tell the truth about you.
I'll be calling your punk ass, you a scared little bitch. Tiptoeing around my name, nigga, you're lame. And when I get at you, homie, don't you tell me you was just playing.
Oh, I was just playing, K-Dot. Come on, you know a nigga rock with you, bro.
Shut the fuck up, you sound like the last nigga I know. Might end up like the last nigga I know. Oh, you don't want to clash, nigga, I know. I put my foot on the gas, head on the floor, hopping out before the vehicle crash. I'm on the road, yelling 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I am the greatest rapper alive. So damn great, motherfucker, I've died. What you hearing now is a paranormal vibe.
I'm not gonna lie, I'm getting hungry. I need a snack. This is part 8. I've literally been doing this for like half an hour. If this is I'm going to put this on YouTube. It's literally going to be a 30-minute video. So if you're watching this on YouTube, shout out to you. And if you're still here, TikTok fam, shout out to you as well. So in the Heart Part 4, Kendrick is basically baiting Drake or Big Sean or both to reply to him and says, call me out, you know, say Candyman's name and I'll come see you. And then on Element on Damn, it seems like he's throwing shots again both of their way, but some of it might be directed towards Drake too. Also note this, because it's going to be important in a second. Kendrick claims that he is the greatest rapper alive at the point. He said he's top five. He also tweeted something like he's not, you know, he's Mr. 1 through 5, claiming that don't even try coming for me, Drake. I am in the top spot right now, and you're going to have to see me up there.
And I don't do it for the gram, I do it for Compton. I'm willing to die for the shit, nigga. I take your fucking life for the shit, nigga. We ain't going back to broke, family selling dope. That's why you any ass rap niggas better know. If I gotta slap a pussy ass nigga, I'ma make it look sexy. If I gotta go hard on a bitch, I'ma make it look sexy. Niggas thought they wouldn't go see me, huh? Niggas thought that K-Dot real life is the same life they see on TV, huh? Niggas wanna flex on me and be in LA for free, huh? Next time they hit the 10 freeway, we need receipt, huh? Cause most of y'all ain't real. Most of y'all go squeal. Most of y'all just envy, but jealousy get you killed. Most of y'all throw rocks and try to hide your hand. Just say his name and I promise that you'll see Candyman.
Again, I think a lot of that was directed at Big Sean after the no interviews verse. No more interviews, sorry. But that's a whole video in itself. Let me know if you want me to do a Big Sean Kendrick Lamar a deep dive, and they're cool now, so you know I'm not trying to re-spark that. But with Drake, he also could be calling him out, like, yo, I know you're talking about being in my city, but there's, you know, there's a cost to being in my city, and if you actually want to come see me, if you want to see me with this rap shit, call me out by name. The Candyman story is basically, if you say Candyman's name, he'll come get you. If you say it 3 times, he's like, say my name, Drake, and let's go. Enough with the subliminals. So what does Drake do? Responds with more subliminals.
Welcome. All that peace and that unity, all that weak shit will ruin me, fuck em. Yeah. Who am I, the do or die? The one with the fewest lies and the truest ties. They try to compare us, but like a job straight out of high school, there's no you and I. I taught you everything you know, now you got student pride. All factual, I call the house the embassy.
This is a callback probably to that Take Care verse on Buried Alive. Buried. Where basically he's giving a bunch of game and advice to Kendrick. He's saying, I taught you everything you know. Don't forget about that. It was like a university class. And now you're turning on me? He also kind of references the lying part that Kendrick says a bunch. You know, don't tell a lie on me. I won't tell the truth about you. But anyways, I'm getting so tired, but we have like one more part. Let's do it. Last time I didn't mention the line that he had on More Life. Because Kendrick said, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, I am the greatest rapper alive on the Hard Part 4.
I know I said top 5, but I'm top 2, and I'm not 2, and I got one, thought you had one, but it's not one, nigga, nah.
But I'm top 2, and I'm not 2, okay? Take that slot. I'm still up here. I'm still on top of the game, okay? Kendrick, sit down. Which is arguable. I think they were both right there, neck and neck, for the top spot in terms of success at that point in the rap game. Damn was huge. More Life, by no means was Drake slowing down, as much as it wasn't as great of a project as his previous albums. I think it was close. Who do you think was actually on top? This is 2017.
Bury me and I'll be born again. I walk in godly form amongst the mortal men.
Referencing Kendrick's Mortal Man, which is the outro on To Pimp a Butterfly, basically saying that his presence is still much higher than any other rapper in the game, including Kendrick. It's funny because they have this back and forth where they just go back and forth about who's on top of the game and who's more successful and if they're on the same level or not. And they're basically just like, you know, talking over each other rather than at each other a lot of the time. But then basically Kendrick goes ghost. It's 3 years. He doesn't really say anything. He said he doesn't even have a cell phone. He's not even talking to anybody. And he comes back out of nowhere when Drake is supposed to drop Certified Lover Boy and Kanye's supposed to drop Donda. And Kendrick comes into the conversation through Baby Keem's Family Ties and says this.
Smoking on your top 5 tonight. I'm smoking on your what's the name tonight.
I am the Omega. PG Lane, Rolly Gang, SIE, don't you address me unless it's with 4 letters. The Elohim, the rebirth. Before you get to the Father, you gotta holler at me first, bitch. Smoking on top 5s. Motherfuck that album, fuck that single. Burn that hard drive.
That shit.
Ain't nobody safe when I come up killing everybody that's outside. Yeah, Kanye changed his life, but me, I'm still an old school Gemini.
Kendrick basically came back out and he said, I am the guy. I don't care what you're dropping. I have been in hiding. Now we can talk. Now we can talk about who's the best now that I'm back, okay? I'm back, bitch. And yeah, that is where we're at today. I know Drake, you know, threw some shots on CLB. I made a whole video about that. But yeah, this was 9 parts. Kendrick and Drake have a very complicated relationship. I'm curious to see on Kendrick's new album if he does throw any shots. It could just be a really artsy, metaphorical album like he's done in the past with To Pimp a Butterfly. But we know that Kendrick is never afraid to even throw shots in between, even on top of that, like we saw with King Kunta or Element and stuff like that. So I'm interested to see what happens. Let me know what you guys think. Who should we cover next on this channel for rap relationships? Thank you guys for sticking with me, and thank you for watching. Love you. Have a great day or evening or night. Love you. Peace.